I think it is about time, you know, as women we take charge. Instead of feeling victimized and cribbing that what we cannot, I think we really need to stand up and stand up for our rights and prove our capability.
They said, you know what, you're too dark and you won't, you know, you don't really look good on the screen. So, you know what, why don't you give your points to somebody else? There was a pretty girl there, but ironically, nearly 15 years later, the same TV channel had invited me for a program for the Rice Bucket Challenge and as a journalist. That time, the complexion didn't matter. I guess my accomplishments were far more than that.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to the third episode of this podcast series, Let's Unwind. So today, the topic of discussion is...
Wait. Today's topic of discussion is women thriving at work. So I think we can handle it from here. Shaumik, thanks a lot.
Okay. The floor is all yours, ladies.
So we're very excited about today's episode because we are going to be in conversation with some very influential leaders in the world of business and journalism. And, you know, in case also you haven't watched our second video, we're going to keep a link on the top right now so that you can click, watch it and come back to this video.
So I was a part of Desire Foundation from the past 4 years, and Desire has always promoted the empowerment of women. 60% of our leadership team till date has been women, and Desire has thrived and achieved great heights under their mentorship. Also, the recent recruitment drive that we had hired almost an equal number of women and men. Last but not the least, in a situation where there is a heavy dropout of kids from school, we at Desire Foundation in 2020 have admitted 95 kids, out of which 40% were girls. So Desire Foundation has not only nurtured strong women, but also have grown with them.
Thank you so much, Bedi. With just that introduction, I would like to invite our highly influential leaders to our podcast today. We have with us Dr. Uttara, who is creating such a big change in the field of management and consultancy. Dr. Uttara is the founder of Uttara Patnaik Consulting Services that focuses on the area of strategy and leadership development.
Our next panelist is a highly influential person. She not only motivates you to become a better version of yourself, but also to spread the goodness to everyone. She is a multifaceted personality. Indian journalist, a city editor of the Indian Express, a feature writer, a columnist, and the founder of the famous Rice Bucket Challenge. So, introducing Miss Manju.
Thank you, Badehi, for that introduction.
We are really delighted to have such an influential and inspiring panelist with us today. Uttara ma'am, could you introduce yourself in some words?
So, you have already said it. I'm a founder of Uttara Patnaik Consulting Services. I'm a ICF certified leadership and executive coach, a NLP practitioner, and a personal mastery expert and strategic leadership advisor. So we are in a mission to basically redefine leadership and strategic concepts. And we want to energize and enable people to build these capabilities, irrespective of their role or levels, you know. So Uttara Patnaik Consulting Services is in a journey to humanize leadership.
Thank you so much, ma'am. We were actually reading through your LinkedIn profile and we were so spellbound. We're like, wow.
All that glitters is not gold.
Manju ma'am.
Yeah. Hi, guys. This is Manju Kalanidhi. I am from Hyderabad, Telangana, in South India. There are two avatars of mine. First avatar is as a journalist. I'm the city editor of the New Indian Express,
Hyderabad. I've been a journalist for the last more than 20 years, and I thoroughly enjoy my profession, primarily because I get to be the voice of the voiceless. My other avatar, actually that is much more famous, as the founder of Rice Bucket Challenge.
Awesome. Manju, I'm so privileged to meet you, even if
same
online.
Same here, Uttaraji. Nice to listen to you from here.
Okay, so we'll begin with our first segment of this podcast. Bedi, you can go ahead.
Okay, so first thing first, let's get the dreaded F word out. Feminism. Several of us have their own definition of feminism. So, Uttara ma'am, how do you define feminism?
So, as you rightly said, Vaidehi, you know, it is a term that everyone defines from their own context and their social conditioning. You know, the definition of feminism in dictionary says that the belief that women should have same rights and opportunities as men. But I think slightly differently. You know, I think that when we kind of connect our definition to a particular gender, we are limiting it. So according to me, feminism is actually living with self-respect and dignity. I wouldn't like to connect it to that it has to be equal to man or equal to, you know, I don't want to tie it down to a particular gender or their benchmark that they have set.
Okay, so the definition varies from person to person. To someone, it might be equal pay. For someone, like you said, it can be living with self-respect. So on that line, every time we take a step towards equality or we take a step towards our definition of feminism, there are instances which takes us several steps backwards. So Manju ma'am, my next question is to you. Statistically speaking, in a year, suppose 2013 to 2014, the Delhi High Commission of Women revealed that 53.2% of the rape cases that they received were false allegations. What is your comment on that?
I think if we are talking about so-called false rape cases, first of all, I don't think any woman would willingly, you know, come and say that unnecessarily that she was victimized or she underwent rape or an assault. So it's sort of absurd to think that they were all made up. I want perhaps us to think about who is saying that these cases are made up. What is their agenda? That still does not take away the fact that in India, there are many more rapes that happen than in any other country, and safety is still a very, very big issue. So even assuming there are a few false cases, that still should not undermine the whole topic and the work that's happening related to prevention of crime.
We don't know what the agenda behind claiming that these cases were false are. So I think I wouldn't say that only rape happens to women, but mostly domestic, violence by men against women is a very high number in our country. Yeah. So recently I came across this statistic by this organization called PayScale. And they said that for every dollar a man earns, a woman earns 98 cents.
I do believe, I mean, this is based on the conversations that happen in the women's media groups. Women are paid lesser. It's more like, if a woman has come back from her maternity leave, apparently some organizations pretend like, oh, you know, we are doing you a favor by actually giving you an opportunity. So you better not, demand what you think you want. You know, for you keep taking leave because of your child. So we think, so this does exist. I'm not denying that. It does exist in the media too. I haven't come across as such. But I think that as and when women have shown their competence handling projects despite, you know, their family backgrounds, despite their personal commitments, I think women have been given very prestigious projects, and that is the starting point for a change. Also, having decision makers. So when women actually are in decision-making capabilities, I think there will be much more change. And like you said, again, we're talking about many different vast categories where, I mean, including in the movie industry, we've been seeing how Deepika and Kangana have been asking for a change in the paycheck. So now that Kangana herself is producing movies, and you know, women who talked about it are in a position, so maybe they will be able to pay a woman DOP the same as what a male DOP gets. So the solution is for us women to sort of get ahead and be the decision makers and make a change.
Completely.
No, I was just saying that to add to what Manju said, I think it is about time, as women we take charge. Instead of feeling victimized and cribbing that what we cannot, I think we really need to stand up and stand up for our rights and prove our capability.
I agree.
Yes, Uttara ma'am, in that context of women taking charge, we have all heard of this thing ki women or girls have it easy. Right? Ki ye to ladki hai, isko easily mil jayega. So, do you have any message to people who say something like this?
I would admit that I have heard this as well. But I don't even feel that, I need to give any explanation or message to not only men, to anybody actually. I am very choosy about where I invest my energy and what kind of battle I choose. And changing other people's perception is not my priority.
Yeah, maybe people have will say whatever they want.
Yeah, people can say whatever they want. Let our work speak for ourselves.
In the context of women activism and women standing up for what they believe, we cannot not talk about what is happening currently, right? In this COVID-19 scenario, when in 2020, where most women and most family members are at home, there has been an incredible rise in the domestic abuse cases, and it has been the highest in the last 10 years.
What is your comment on that?
Okay, so I personally, as a journalist in Hyderabad, I did a special story on how there has been a rise in domestic violence. And then it was also a lot of sexual on women to have intercourse with men just because they think good or unwanted. They are not able to go drinking. They are not able to hang out with friends. There has been this thing, and unfortunately, I don't think anything really concrete has happened, especially during the lockdown. There were no options. The government, everybody was fighting the virus, but not the crime at home.
Yeah, as ma'am rightly said, we were busy fighting the virus. So we have to fight the real virus, which is in our mind.
Agreed. Moving on to our next segment, I would like to direct this question to Uttara ma'am. So I noticed that you shifted from PhD in cardiovascular toxicity to a completely management and consulting profile. So like, what was the story behind that? What made you shift?
Okay, so before I come into this, I'll tell you the story. But before that, let me say something how I think about it. Personally, I do not really think that it's like a complete change from my career. Because as you go higher in the career ladder, you are basically achieving results through people, right? So there also my job was to achieve results through people. And now also my job is to achieve results through people. Only thing is that when I'm part of the organization, my vested interest is there, So say, for example, if you are reporting to me and I'm coaching you, or I'm trying to achieve results through you, the target that you have is also my target, because I'm a supervisor, we are part of the same organization, same department. So there is an agenda that I have as well. And so I feel that when I come out of it and I work as an external consultant with people, then I am working from a much more authentic space because I'm genuinely interested in enabling you. Right. Mm-hmm. So that is one. So I personally feel that, it's a different type of achieving results through people. And also over the period of time, I have educated myself in different methodology, how we can do it more meaningfully. Having been part of healthcare and understanding neuroscience better, you know, because if you are are educated, you first have to know the physiology, which is basic, something that we study in our BSc or 11-12 or something. So if you understand human mind well, you understand neuroscience well, then lots of your whys are answered, you know. So anything that we do, what we are doing is the what, the methodology is the how, and why is actually the science. And the science of behavioral science is neuro-linguistic program. It's called NLP. So I think there is a huge advantage when you understand the science, you know, because that definitely gives me a lot more conviction, because before I work with clients, I know why it is happening. I'm able to pick up lots of nonverbal cues, because what we express in words is a very small percentage of it. How we behave, how we, manage our reactions, our thought process, our feelings, emotion, tonality, pace, and all are all signs. So that really helps me to understand that.
Currently, your story is also very inspiring to me, because I'm in that stage of my life where I am making some decisions for myself. And another personal thing that had happened to my life was, when I was in about 2 years into my work life, my parents thought, well, they were heavily influenced by a lot of, relatives, if I must, that, you know, it's the right age or the justified age for your daughter to get married. So because they were so influenced by that, they didn't think, you know, my thought of having a master's wasn't a very justified thought in their head. So, at that point of time in my life, I felt very insignificant, as in I felt that, okay, so I studied all this, I worked for so many years just to equate to one societal norm of marriage. So at that point, I was very frustrated, and I decided that, I wish I was a male, because cousins my age were not being asked the same question, who were males. So did you ever face anything like that? Where you decided that, okay, no, first doesn't feel right.
I'm brought up in a place called Shantiniketan, which is a central university founded by Rabindranath Tagore. Mm-hmm. And a place where you are just an individual. You are not a man, woman. Today this concept of inclusivity came, which we have seen probably for 30 years back, or it was always there. But having said that, marriage is beautiful. You know, if you have a person where there is compatibility and understanding and respect, you need a friend in life, and it's beautiful. But it is, you have to feel the need of it. You know, it should not be that right. At this age, it should do. There was right. A time when people like women needed a man in their life for being a provider. Not anymore. You know, right. Things have changed.
Right. So, ma'am, would you say that the biggest decisions that you've made in your life, it was easier to make them because you had a partner by your side?
I make my own decisions. But yes, my partner definitely was very, very supportive. You know, I married my best friend whom I knew since I was 18 years old. So, it made life easier. And my husband definitely has to play a very big role in continuing how I lived my life and making choices. Having the space to make decision, not feeling the pressure is definitely, I would say that, I'm grateful that I had that privilege.
Yeah. True, and that's very lucky and a good thing that you also had an environment in which you thrived to be what you are today.
Yes, ma'am, we can be the driver of our own success. So that is how we can, instead of cribbing about something, as you rightly said, we can drive the change. We can be the change maker.
Absolutely. You guys are already doing. Just keep up the good work.
Thank you so much.
Okay, so Manju ma'am, talking about the Dark is Beautiful campaign, the motto of that campaign is to see beauty beyond the boundaries of color. So, in your childhood, have you ever faced any situation like this where you were judged on the regular standards of beauty?
Yes, I did face that. I remember, I think I was in college, and there was a TV show that had come to my city. I mean, at that point of time, I was not living in Hyderabad. I was living in a smaller city. So a TV channel from Hyderabad had come to take the opinions of people for on a particular subject. It was called Praja Vedika, which means a dais for the people. And I was actually one of the people who really spoke on whatever the subject was. I don't exactly remember. It was something to do with students and choices and things like that. They spoke very well. They had actually, shortlisted me. But then finally, when they had to put me in the panel for the TV, they said, you're too dark and you don't really look good on the screen. Why don't you give your points to somebody else? There was a pretty girl there. But ironically, nearly 15 years later, the same TV channel had invited me for a program for the Rice Bucket Challenge. And as a journalist, that time, the complexion didn't matter. I guess my accomplishments were far more than that.
Will you let your success speak?
Yes, I do. People often also tell me that because of my complexion, I should wear pastels, I should wear creams and beiges and that kind of clothes. So if you see my choice of color today, it's a bright yellow, really bright sunny yellow with a matching jacket. So I felt like this is me. And today, if you see my Instagram feed, it's full of colorful things and I'm totally enjoying it. Like people say, you're killing it. So I guess sometimes you just have to take the and be there.
And you are looking beautiful, Manju.
Yeah, you're killing it with your
friends. Yes, you are killing it.
Thank you, Dr. Uttara. Thank you. So are you guys. Yeah.
But what you're telling, right? The social standards of beauty, like that guy said, you're not good for the camera, you're not good for the phone down, maybe you give your points. So these things are, we have to understand why these things are coming. So in a country, we live in such a scenario where till 2020 there was a famous ban which had the word fair. So that is how we are conditioned to believe from a very early childhood. So we have to unlearn these things, and that is the point of education, I feel. So the thing we all want to know, Manju ma'am, the Rice Bucket Challenge. This was an international phenomenon and everyone wants to know about it, and so many people were inspired from it. Like, it was your own brainchild, right? And even we, Desire Foundation, have taken inspiration from it, and we also executed the Rice Bucket Challenge in Bhubaneswar in 2014. So, you might have heard a lot of questions about it, but still we want to know, see, what was your idea behind it? How did this idea come into your mind? And How did this it was started 6 years back, and how did it evolve over the years, and what are you doing currently on it since we cannot go to the regular methodology now?
So I know Desire Foundation from the time that you guys did in 2014 when we started the campaign. So that's how I know Desire, and I have been following your work. You are doing absolutely great work. The Ice Bucket Challenge, and it's about simple, let's feed the hungry. If somebody is hungry, let's give them food. Initially, it was offline 5 years, 6 years ago. There was not so much of technology. So if there was an... So the simple concept is give a bucket of rice, feed the needy. And people would take it up like a campaign, you know, one person would donate to an orphanage or an old age home or somebody needy, and then tag three more people, and then those three more people would do and tag more. So it sort of became viral at that point of time. I remember we even trended on Twitter on one day for 10,000 times. It's actually officially recorded. So it started like that, where we started feeding people who we know, and sort of do this like a movement. But today, because of technology, we are able to garner donations online and give it to wherever is necessary. In COVID-19, it's... So what we do is, just a few days after the lockdown started, and the migrant workers problem started. So we started a campaign online, and we weren't sure. We thought, "Arey, abhi lockdown hai, everybody is busy. How will we even get anything?" But we started. We thought we'll generate about 5,000 kgs. Since I think April 2nd or 3rd, our campaign went live. We have collected 27,000 kgs of groceries, and we have been sending it to whoever have requested us. It could be migrant labor communities, it could be community kitchens. And then like somebody from the weavers community would get in touch with me and say, "Madam, there are so many weavers, can we do something?" So we have put together kits, you know, rice and dal and wheat, oil, some kit which they could cook, so that at least among various problems, they don't have to think about providing for the family. Like, I have personally sent my groceries to around 78 points in Hyderabad and a few other places. We've sent to Bangalore. In fact, we are doing now a campaign for the Mumbai Dabba Wallas also. I have just released 30,000 rupees for that. It is yet to reach them, so I'll talk about it over that. So it's a very simple thing. We open a campaign online. If anybody wants to participate, click on the link, see how much rice they need, how much wheat they need, donate the amount. And once we hit our target, we release the amount in bulk and we buy it locally, which is why I think Rice Bucket Challenge is popular. So far, we've collected 18 lakhs worth groceries in the last, in the lockdown. And it is all through common people like you. And I thank all the NRIs who have given us from rupees 45 to rupees 3 lakh. Rice Bucket Challenge has received its funds from across the world, and that's why we are able to feed so many people. So that's how it stands currently.
This was a very interesting segment. As young minds, we really learned what leaders actually think.
So we actually are going to the last segment of our podcast,
okay,
which is a very exciting segment, as our youth coordinator calls it, rapid fire. It's not the coffee with Karan rapid fire round. Sorry, there are no hampers at the end of this. So, you know, just like, let's be rapid and add more fire to our answers. So I'll start with Utra.
Okay.
So your first words or reactions that come to your mind when I say the following words. First is women CEOs.
Powerful.
Period leaves.
Not required.
Poverty.
Lack of dignity.
Next question is one thing that you've done and you are extremely proud of it.
I think I'm most proud about my authenticity.
Absolutely. Okay. Your biggest role model or mentor?
Everybody. I actually get inspired by very small little things. Like right now, I'm getting inspired by you guys. And I'm thinking that, you know, I remember when Baidehi and Shaumik approached to me, I'm like, oh my God, at this age, did I even add value? So I get inspired by very small little things where people are making an effort, you know. People are doing something different than others. That really inspires me. And no such role model as such, because I'm a very bad follower, actually. You know, I mean, I take bits and pieces from whatever I like, and I like giving my own unique color to it and making it my own.
Okay, wonderful. And a word of advice that you would want to give young girls.
Take charge. You guys are powerful. Identify your own resources and be the leader you wish to be.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Over to you, Vedi.
Okay, Manju ma'am, are you ready for it?
Yes, absolutely. Fire away.
Okay. I'll tell you three words and you have to give the first reaction or the first word which comes to your mind. So the first word is Republic.
Arnav Goswami.
Okay, second word, language.
Communication.
Okay, and last but not the least, Arjun Reddy.
Arjun Reddy, yay! But also, bad role model. Watch it as a movie, but don't get inspired to do what he does. Learn from it.
Okay, talking about role models, ma'am, who is your role model and who is the mentor you look up to?
I have 2-3 role models. One is in terms of charity and philanthropy, it is Sudha Murthy. In terms of being diplomatic but still going ahead and moving and you know creating new horizons is Priyanka Chopra, and Shobha Day for the way she speaks and the way she writes and the way she just doesn't give a hoot about what others give. So on those three, I like these three very, very spunky women on this.
Yeah. We definitely have 2 new role models today to add.
Yes.
And ma'am, your advice to young girls?
2 advices. First, don't take advice. Yeah. Chart out whole thing. Your life, your dreams, your wishes, your choices. So do what it takes. Frankly, when I tell my daughter also that, I can never give you advice because I don't know what you want in life. You should choose. 2, don't blend in. Why blend in if you can stand out? So don't try to fit in and be there and do what others say. You think you can stand out and do what it takes. I mean, be it a choice of a profession or choice of a partner. Do it if you're confident and rock it.
Beautiful.
And any word on the media focus these days?
We deserve the news we get. So make the right choice so that you get what you want.
Yeah, it all starts with you. Ma'am, the last question to both of you, one line of this podcast.
Thank you so much. You guys had amazing questions. And because you are young, you are beautiful, you're talented, you're asking the right questions. And you made us be on this. So you guys are the new 2 role models. And of course, Desire Foundation has been doing great work. Keep up the work, guys. And Uttara, I really love what you have been doing. I'm going to check you out and your previous interviews.
Same here. So I'm really glad to have this opportunity. And, my relationship with Desire Foundation goes a little long way. So I've always inspired by what you guys have done and doing continuously. You guys are bringing education to people, changing the world, because I sincerely believe that education gives you clarity of thought, and if you can think clearly, you can your action will be something that you can take responsibility for. So I am really happy to have this opportunity and really humbled and grateful that you chose me to spend the morning with you. So thank you for giving me this opportunity to walk a few steps with you guys. Thank you.
Thank you so much for having this conversation with us. I think Bethy would agree that we actually learned a lot through this conversation. It wasn't just an interview. It was more of something to share and something to put forth. So thank you so much, Uttara ma'am and Manju ma'am, for opening our eyes to so many new things and new dimensions and giving us great advice. We're so happy that we got to host you. Thank you so much.
Hey guys, so you have reached the end of episode 3. Thank you for sticking around. We truly hope you enjoyed this episode.
So as the drill goes, make sure you like the video if you liked it.
Comment your favorite part from the video in the comment section below.
Share this video with all your friends and family to amplify the voices of women.
And don't forget to press the subscribe button and click the bell icon to keep yourself updated whenever we post any new video.
Last but not the least, we have left the links to our donation pages and the social media handles of our guests. Show your love. And we will be seeing you in the next video. Thank you. Bye.